ladies spoke. I like the way to dribble up and down the court, just like I'm the king on the microphone. So it's Dr. J and Moses Malone. I like slam dunks, take me to the hoop. My favorite play is the alley oop. I like the pick and roll, I like the give and go, cause it's basketball, but Mr. Curtis Blow.
Season because of the hard work that we put in together, but every day was a battle, man. The starting lineup would change just depending on how you practice. So you may have Coleman starting 1 week, Darryl getting starting the next week, Robert Carr starting the next week. You had a bunch of different, depending on how you practice, man. And we used to get in, it used to be some physical practices was better than the game. Discipline. Coach is gonna bring you discipline no matter if you're the superstar, the 12th man on the team, you gonna follow the rules, and you know me, they had to give me extra duties. Oh, he ran the managers and everyone, but I tried to come in here with the Houston talk and tails and all kind of fly haircuts, and he let me go all the way to the season start and said, now I know you're gonna do the right thing. We're a unified team. I don't want any individuality here, so I had to cut my tail off, man. But most thing I can say about Coach, man, he's a disciplinarian, and but he was a father figure also. You know, everybody went to him. He pat you on your head when you done well, and he gonna kick you in your butt when you didn't do well. Then we had a 7-point lead at halftime. And if you were behind the Marlin Bulldog team in 87 at halftime, you were about to get thrashed second half. If we played that game 10 times, they probably would have won only that one game out of 10. I don't know about them, I still wake up thinking, I won the game 30 years later. Still to this day, it haunts me to this day, but hey, after all, we look back on it. We were talking today about how many games did we lose. We lost 4 games out of 35. So now I can tell my kids, and they plus, you know, Coach called us back, and we went back and helped a lot of the teams that he had success with from 87 on. You know, we had a lot of successful teams. Hey, y'all guys, come up here, man. Work out with the guys and show them what it is to be a Bulldog. It's a privilege, man. I'm glad to see my boys all together.
It's great. And, you know, everybody came to for us, to for the town, and for Coach Green to even think of this for us, because it was a great time in our lives. We remember to this day, and until somebody go 31-4, we it, you know. So we issuing challenges. You know, that squad, we ready anytime, anywhere. 87 come out of retirement for me.
Yeah. I mean, we had the debates, who's better. Like I told a lot of guys from 88 up, if we had 3-point line, we'd have 150 points a game.
Yeah.
And that's a good, you know, and just the debate. And I told them, I said, we are arguably the best to ever walk through Marlin High School, ever play on that hard top. Dog, relentless.
Johnny was a dog.
That was dog eat dog. As a freshman, sophomore, dog eat dog. But he, you know, he good. I mean, like I said, everything was. He was the value that Coach Green had. You know, raising kids. You seen the son out there tonight. Same value, same thing. I still try to tell him the same thing. You know, he's not here, but just remember, everything's still there.
Benny was a prankster, man. Benny was a prankster, man. As serious as basketball was for us, Benny was never serious.
He was always playing, man.
He left his jersey. Remember, he left his jersey? He had to pay $80 to graduate. He left his jersey in Lubbock. But got it, man.
He was a prankster, man, and he was
superior athlete, man. Superior athlete.
He was a go-getter when he was on the court, but on the bus, in the locker room, if it came to cracking jokes, Ben was going to be the one, you know, other than D. Scott over here.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
I'm going to get
he missed the Bowie game because he was always in everybody's sack lunches, begging and ate some bad bologna and tore his stomach.
I came back just in time to hit that free throw, though. I came back just in time. I mean, these younger teams, they remember us coming in this gym, man. They, oh, man, Coach Green, Kyle, you're this younger brother. Michael Coleman was at 92, Fred Lane, Coach Benny Hewitt. We used to come up here, man, we put in work. Hey, man, Coach, you call them up here. Same way we was with the older guys that came back with us, the Slickies, Willie Washington, Roger Alexander, Lou Tyler, rest in peace.
Big A.
Big A, they showed us love, man. They got us where we needed to be, but that's what I think Marlon's missing now. Nobody's coming back to give back to them. We out, we 47, 48 years old now, so it's got to be another generation to come back, man, and help them out.
Well, initially, I did not want to share my dad. I was very possessive of my dad because we had a very tight relationship, but I did understand. Being a teacher, I understand it even more. But I did share him, but you know, sometimes I held on to him a lot tighter. It was just a privilege actually to have a father at home. And not just have one who was at home, but one who was present and available. And just always supportive, even in his busy schedule, he was still very supportive. What I remember a lot about my dad is after a game, no matter how late it was, he was always reviewing tapes. I'm like, does he ever sleep? But you know, basketball was his thing. Another thing that I really admired about him, it did not matter if you were the star player or if you were the person who rolled the bench. You had to get it academically. If you didn't have it academically, you were not playing. If you didn't follow the rules, you were not playing. Some of the guys tried to try him, and they found out he was true to his word, a man of integrity.